So, this is how it begins. With one game. One title that I love calling me back again. How I've missed Silent Hill. In all seriousness though, who would go through all the trouble of inviting me to some random shed in the middle of nowhere just to grab a copy of this game? Wait. Is this another note? Dear Shop Z, in your restless dreams, I know you see this game, Silent Hill 2. You promised you'd visit it again, but you... darn it.
I ain't reading all that.
Anyway, let's get into Silent Hill 2. I think if we want to talk about this game, it would probably be best to talk about the franchise as a whole. Silent Hill was started by Team Silent, a team Konami made up of its misfits, the people who weren't fitting in with other teams, or the people who were viewed as troublesome and unproductive. This team was given one task: make a rival to Capcom's Resident Evil. As expected of the oddballs of the company, they made something unique and genuinely terrifying in a way that Resident Evil really was not. You see, Silent Hill, the original game on the PlayStation 1, was one of the first ones to focus on a more subtle and psychological horror. Sure, there were some scenes where it was very bloody and very gory, but a lot of those more so played off of body horror than something like zombies or dinosaurs or whatever in the world Parasite Eve was doing. Now, Silent Hill on the PS1 was a very successful game, and Konami, being the money-hungry goblins they are, ordered Team Silent, probably at gunpoint, to make this game, Silent Hill 2. Silent Hill 2 is widely regarded as the best in the series and one of the best horror games of all time, due to its narrative, due to some extent, its graphics, and just how much of an impact this game has had on the horror genre. As such, I felt that even though Sharp Z Reviews is probably going to mostly cover more obscure indie games, I wanted to take some time to cover what I view as one of the most influential games on the horror genre. So, yeah, before we get all the way into this, we should probably discuss my grading scale, which is another reason I actually picked this game. It exemplifies it quite well. These categories are as follows. Gameplay, which answers how does the game play, does it feel well, does it control properly. Narrative or premise, which is how well is the game written. The reason that there are two qualifiers for this category are because some games don't really have a complicated overarching narrative. For example, the original Mario Bros. Games just have a very basic Rescue the Princess premise, but I would argue that's really fine. It's not something I can really dock the game on. Graphics, which is how does the game look, and an asterisk here, when I say graphics, I will be comparing the game to its peers, not to other games released around the time, and if it has a unique visual style that is trying to emulate something else, that's what I will aim it for. It's more so based on does the game have a meshing graphical style, do the graphics look like it was an intentional choice and well designed, or something that was just a byproduct of lazy design. Audio, which is how does the game sound? This covers everything from soundtrack to basic audio and sound design. And finally, and this is the one that is probably the most unique on the grading scale and part of the reason why I actually picked Silent Hill 2, cohesion, which is how do all of these factors work together in the complete product. Now, for a heads up for anyone who wants to play the game without any spoilers whatsoever, yes, I do think it's a good game to go into. There are quite a few releases of Silent Hill 2. Granted, not all of them are fairly accessible, and unfortunately, it is not, to my knowledge, available in any online store at the moment, aside from the HD collection. If you want my opinions on that, here's what I think of the HD collection. All jokes aside though, if that is the only way that you can find to play the game, I guess it's better than nothing. But looking at the other ports really quickly, the PlayStation 2 port has the best cutscenes, mainly due to the fact that the PlayStation 2 had an inbuilt DVD player, so high-quality cutscenes were not out of the question. The Xbox version, due to the better performance of the original Xbox console, has slightly better gameplay graphics, a few marked improvements as well, but the cutscenes are not as high quality as they would be on the PS2. Alongside this, the Xbox version also featured the Born from a Wish expansion, which I would argue is not the biggest make or break deal. But it also lets you turn off the noise filter from the beginning, which, if you are playing on one of the versions that allows you to do that, I would highly recommend. After that, we have the PlayStation 2 Greatest Hits Edition, which some of you might be asking why I'm talking about the PS2 again. The Greatest Hits Edition just adds the content from the Xbox version into the PS2 version. And then we have one final version, which is the version I'm playing, which is the PC port. And when I say I'm playing, it's via a technicality. You see, the original PC release was pretty bad, but there is a fan patch called the Enhanced Edition, which is absolutely phenomenal. Any of the footage that you're going to be seeing in the background is going to be footage of me playing the Enhanced Edition port on my laptop. So, if you want to get into the game without any chance of spoilers, now is your time to dip out. But if you're fine with maybe the first 15 or so minutes of gameplay being spoiled, that's absolutely fine because that's what we're about to get into. Gameplay-wise, Silent Hill 2 is okay. The movement controls, while more loose than games like Resident Evil, still at times feel stilted. The run and walk speed are fine, but sometimes I cannot seem to find the right balance with the analog stick, as you'll see in the clips here. So if you want to play with sprint button, it's a perfectly acceptable option. However, there is one thing where I would argue the controls are pretty bad. And that is the attack and combat system, especially in the PS2 and Xbox versions. Now, even though I'm playing the PC port, I was playing with a little bit of these controls. Usually, I recommend to map them to an analog stick, but if you want an example, the attacks are mapped so that however hard you press the button determines how hard the attack is, and while in concept that sounds fine, in execution, it usually sounds like you're trying to break your finger. For example, please observe.
Is it dead?
In my opinion, where the game really excels gameplay-wise is in the puzzles. Granted, within the first 15 minutes, there's not really any puzzles that I can record since a lot of it's just set up. But what I can say is, with the options that they offer you when it comes to puzzles, you have plenty of options. If you want to play in a easier fashion or a harder fashion, whether you're good at puzzles or not, there's usually a good option for you. That and the riddles are a good variety. You have a few that involve things like combination locks. There's a few where it relies on riddles, but overall, the puzzles do fit the game. If I'm being honest, while the gameplay is not perfect, it's not terrible either. I would say most of the time, it feels fairly decent to play, and there were very few times outside of the combat system where I felt like the game was not controlling properly. The narrative of Silent Hill 2 is widely regarded as one of the best stories in the world of horror gaming. Silent Hill 2 is a psychological horror game, and as a psychological piece of media, I feel it succeeds. Players will exit with many questions, some of which cannot be answered to a satisfactory degree. Most of this is due to ambiguity, which I would argue is intentional, especially since if you ask the developers, a lot of them say that it's meant to be left intentional. I can't really elaborate too much on the story without spoiling, so I'll just give a basic premise. As James Sunderland receives a letter from his deceased wife, he decides to enter the town of Silent Hill and meet her once
You
again.
promised you'd take me there again someday.
But you never did. Well, I'm alone there now. In our special place. Waiting for you.
I got a letter. The name on the envelope said, Mary. My wife's name. It's ridiculous. Couldn't possibly be true. That's what I keep telling myself. A dead person can't write a letter. Mary died of that damn disease 3 years ago. So then, why am I looking for her? Our special place. What could she mean? This whole town was our special place. Excuse me, I...
I'm sorry. I was just...
No, it's okay. I didn't mean to scare you. I'm
kind of lost. Graphically, Silent Hill was originally released on the PS2, so it would only be fair to compare it to other games released during this time period. Regarding in-game models and assets, I would say the game holds up decently well. The player character has many unique animation changes and quirks throughout the game. For example, when James runs too fast, he needs to catch his breath. The way he swings weapons doesn't have the same finesse as someone who is a trained combatant. But even outside of James, NPC characters animate well most of the time, with the monsters in particular being a highlight. There's this uncanny, unnatural quality to a lot of them, and it's honestly haunting, especially with some of the monsters you see later in the game. Outside of that, fog and lighting effects are absolutely phenomenal for the PlayStation 2, with the fog being of particular note since, as with Silent Hill 1 and Silent Hill 2, it is mainly used to mask visual imperfections or hardware limitations of the PS2. The fog, for those who are unaware, was used to mask the low render distance that the high-quality graphics of Silent Hill 2 caused. But, well, it's kind of provided Silent Hill with its own aesthetic, to the point where even if you look at the remake today, one of the big things that I saw people talking about was they got the fog right. That's one thing that I cared about. Granted, the best visual aspect of this game by far, though, was the CGI cutscenes. These cutscenes, which were also a part of Silent Hill 1, reappeared in Silent Hill 2 and were at the time actually a major selling point of the game. Sometimes these cutscenes look uncannily realistic, but other times they fall into the uncanny valley. However, since this is a horror game and a game on the PlayStation 2, I don't really feel like I can dock it for that. Honestly, the Uncanny Valley effect kind of works to its benefit in some weird ways. The design also extends to the UI, where if you are looking right now, you see there is none. There is a pause menu that is very minimalistic and simplistic. But honestly, there's just one thing I would say about the game visually that you would probably need to heed. If you are playing on a version where you can turn the noise filter off, I would highly recommend doing so. Leaving the noise filter on can be a little distracting, and while at times the game is stunningly beautiful, that filter can have some weird effects on it. Overall, I would give Silent Hill a... Audio. Well, before we talk about music, I just have one thing to say. It's Silent Hill. Akira Yamaoka's work on the entire Silent Hill franchise is amazing. Among horror soundtracks, it's one that is often regarded as a style to emulate, but a style that has quite unique and never fully been recaptured by anyone else. Soundtrack, no notes. Voice acting, while stilted and uncanny at times, does fit the game to an extent, and after looking at behind-the-scenes footage from this game, I'm led to believe that was a very intentional choice. All casting choices do seem fitting, at least for the original cast. Yeah, I'm gonna talk about it briefly. The HD remake recasts the entire Silent Hill 2 cast, and while I do like some of the actors involved, I'm not gonna act like the new casting choice wasn't one of the worst parts of the game for me. It just doesn't have the same feel as the original, and even though it might technically be better, it does not fit Silent Hill 2 as well. General sound design outside of this is also pretty great. From opening and closing doors, to walking, to monsters, it all just works. At times, the sound works so well, I can just turn off the analysis part of my brain and absorb myself into the foggy streets of Silent Hill. And now for the final category, cohesion. As I alluded to earlier, I think this game perfectly exemplifies cohesion. And before I explain why, I think I should explain what cohesion is. Simply put, cohesion is our judgment of how well the mechanics of the game intertwine and complement with everything else. Games like Xenoblade and Majora's Mask intertwine their story and their gameplay mechanics. For example, with Xenoblade's Monado and Majora's Mask's whole time travel clock loop. Resident Evil's tank controls also come to mind. While these controls are clunky and not the most fun way to control a game, they do work to accomplish what Resident Evil's trying to do. Everything in Silent Hill 2 centers around one thing. The narrative, the audio, graphics, and gameplay all work together to immerse the player in the foggy town of Silent Hill. And when I say there's a singular goal, some of it's spoiler-related, but yes, everything in this game works together very well. Some of the things that I mentioned that I would regard as issues if they were in other games, for example, stilted voice acting. While I love some of the scenes from the old Mega Man Zero games, there are undoubtedly a few Mega Man X cutscenes that have not aged well. And Devil May Cry 2. I'm sorry, Capcom fans. I didn't mean to open an old wound. But with Silent Hill 2, the voice acting is an intentional choice. The music, which is phenomenal, is an intentional choice. Everything down to the slightly uncanny nature of cutscenes is, I believe, an intentional choice. Silent Hill 2, from one end of the game to the very other, is completely designed around the town of Silent Hill. Everything in this game feels like it's working together. It doesn't feel like this game was designed by five or six people in separate rooms, all throwing assets together. This feels like a game where the team was constantly communicating and constantly had a singular vision of what they wanted. And as such, this gets a 5 out of 5 for cohesion. Which means, yeah, I fully recommend it. Now, with all the spoiler-free or first 15-minute spoiler stuff out of the way, let's begin by hopping into a short summary. Now, granted, while you would probably expect someone like me to make this summary be fairly serious because I love this game, I'm not going to do that because there are two types of people here. There's the ones who have already read the story, people who probably played around Halloween, so might as well do a funny recap for them, and there's also people who've never played the game, and, well, while I acknowledge that I can't get all of you out due to spoilers, I feel like at least making the story entertaining enough that you might want to seek it out would be a good idea. So, let's enter the foggy town of Silent Hill and begin this retrospective. Silent Hill 2 follows James Sunderland, a man entering the town of Silent Hill upon receiving a letter from his wife Mary to meet her at their special place. Darn it, Mary. Why are you always so vague? You could have at least given me the street. I don't know what special place means. Oh yeah, also, just one small detail I forgot to mention. His wife is dead, and has been dead for the past few years. James concludes the place she is talking to about is probably Rosewater Park, and heads on the pathway towards Silent Hill. After a brief jaunt in the forest, James enters a graveyard and meets Angela, a mysterious lady who is looking for her mother. Angela urges us not to enter the town of Silent Hill, but James ain't having it and enters anyway. After entering, we see a strange-looking man, and James decides to ask for directions. We make chase, but it turns out it's not a man, it's a monster. At this point, we get our first weapon, as well as the radio. This radio allows you to hear when monsters are nearby. Today's Residential Punishment of Sins is sponsored by Raid Shadow Legends.
What the? I'd better take it anyway. I might need it.
After re-entering the streets, we briefly do some window shopping and borrow a key from a corpse. What? It's a corpse. It can't use it. This key leads into a series of apartments. After we enter the lobby, we head upstairs, but we kind of run into a few issues. Fortunately, we find a light, but unfortunately, legs. Look at them. We find a gun in a shopping cart because America, I guess? We also see a key through the grate and reach for it, but are stopped by the worst monster of all. A child.
Ow! Hey, wait!
Damn it.
After a few puzzles and a few well-deserved home runs with a wooden plank and monster heads, we see James' personal punishment, Pyramid Head.
Witness your worst enemy, James. Geometry.
Shenanigans ensue, a few more puzzles, yada yada. We meet Eddie, a gluttonous man with a slightly unstable personality and some unique tastes in food. Seriously, man, what's in your fridge? After a few more puzzles and a few more button-bashing segments of bashing monsters' heads in, we receive the fire escape key and enter the next building over. We do some impromptu plumbing, find some bullets and keys, and visit Angela once again. This time she has a friend, but the friend is a knife.
Oh,
she decides to leave it and hands James a knife, which James refuses to use, but hey, it is a nice display piece. After this, we finally get to face our fears, but it turns out the triangles are immune to bullets. Die, you stupid red pyramid! Why are you taking so many bullets?
What's the formula for an area of a triangle, James? I know you know it.
This battle is actually on a timer, so the bullets just pretty much slow him down. Anyway, we'll talk about that in the gameplay section, but moving back to it. We finally get to exit these apartments and go back into the foggy streets of Silent Hill. But waiting for us is the little spawn of Satan. But she gives us one piece of information before we leave, saying that we never loved Mary, which would be weird to think about because James kind of already came here, so... That's not important. What's more important is that James has finally arrived at Rosewater Park.
Mary?
And there she is. Mary?
My name is Maria. I don't look like a ghost, do I?
Anyway, Maria encourages us to keep searching for Mary and change our location to Lakeview Hotel. During our brief jaunt to try to find a way over there, we head into a bowling alley, and there we see Eddie and the cursed one yet again. And Eddie reveals that the cursed one's name is apparently Laura.
Wait, come back.
Before Eddie, Laura runs away.
Huh? Laura? Why?
Maria and James decide to try to find and protect the kid. However, this kid, due to her demon genes within her, is way too fast for them.
It's locked.
The two decide to make chase and head through a few various buildings, like a club, which Maria knows how to pick the lock to for some reason. Eventually, a hospital.
James, hurry! We need to save the kid!
But do we really, though? We head upstairs, but we don't have insurance, so the staff is hostile. We find a shotgun in a locker for some reason. Maria gets down with the sickness, Pyramid Head tackles James off a roof, and a few more puzzles, yada yada. We finally find Laura.
What are you doing, Step Laura? What are you doing, stepdaughter?
What are you doing?
Any means. Watch, I'm gonna say that and still die. But it is just so, so draining.
After we defeat the rotisserie chickens on children's swings, I don't know what these are. We enter the other world. We find Maria again, and she's mad, but no, Pyramid Head's back.
Answer me, Sunderland. How many degrees are in this angle?
Open up!
James!
Oh no, I know this scene. Oh.
Maria!
No. Complete tangent. So has anyone here seen, if anyone here has seen these Silent Hill movies, for some reason, in those movies, Pyramid Head is absolutely ripped. And I was texting a friend about it, and I go, why did they make Pyramid Head hot in these movies?
We escape, but Maria gets stabbed. We take the elevator down, exit the hospital, but now everything's dark outside. We follow a map, find a wrench, and use the wrench to get some key out of the ground, yada yada. We then enter the Silent Hill Historical Society.
You know, the funny thing is, any town other than Silent Hill, the name Historical Society sounds like a cult. I'm gonna be honest, I don't know if anyone who's part of a historical society would end up watching one of my streams, but if you do, what do you guys do in those buildings? And, do you have to kill me if you tell me? Because if you tell me, and you had to kill me, then I might not want to know. It's not a cognito hazard, right? Forgot how many massive staircases are in this game.
Below the society, we find a hole. We jump in, we enter a well, break the wall, enter into prison. After a few more puzzles, we jump down a few more holes, and noclip into the back rooms. I forgot about the great knife. Ooh, boy. We find Maria once again with her telling James to come to the other side of the bars and free her.
You were always so forgetful. Remember that time in the hotel?
Maria?
You said you took everything. But you forgot that videotape we made. I wonder if it's still there.
On the way to Maria, we find Angela in a room with a monster. We kill it and Angela leaves.
That's ridiculous.
After this, we solve a brief puzzle with nooses and enter Maria's cell, but...
Maria? Maria?
Maria, no! What happened to you? Why? Why?
After entering a graveyard that is under the cell for some reason, I don't know, do I look like I design ancient mazes designed to torture people? We enter a meat freezer and see Eddie once again, but he's lost it.
What does it look like? He always busted my balls.
I'm committing a murder.
That disgusting piece of shit. You make me sick. Fat ass, you're nothing but a waste of skin. You're so ugly, even your mama don't love you. Well, maybe he was right. Maybe I am nothing but a fat, disgusting piece of shit. But you know what? It doesn't matter if you're smart, dumb, ugly, pretty. It's all the same once you're dead.
And the corpse can't laugh.
From now on, if anyone makes fun of me, I'll kill him. Just like that.
Oh no.
Eddie, have you gone nuts?
I knew it.
You too. You're just like him, James.
Hey, I didn't mean anything.
Don't bother. I understand. You've been laughing at me all along, haven't you?
Yes.
Ever since we first met.
Yes.
I'll kill you, James.
Do it, coward. You look like a grown-up version of a kid from the Magic School Bus. After exchanging a few words and bullets with the guy, we kill him and James
Eddie?
Breaks a little bit.
I killed a human being. A human being.
That should be it. There's the... After defeating him, we enter a rowboat and cross the lake into the Lakeview Hotel. Row your boat, James. Row it. Work it, Jameson. Work it. James looks so proud of himself. It's a self-playing piano. Oh.
Did I scare you?
Yeah, you did.
Darn it, Laura. After entering, we meet Laura once again. She gives us a letter left by Mary, and, well, after this, we go throughout the hotel a little bit more, find the VHS tape that was left at the hotel, and eventually find a room with a working VHS player to play the tape.
Are you taping again? Come on. I don't know why, but I just love it here. It's so peaceful. You know what I heard? This whole area used to be a sacred place. I think I can see why. It's too bad we have to leave. Please promise you'll take me again, James.
Oh, this is my TV reflecting off my... I will say, this is one scene that is way more effective if you play it on CRT. Like, old tube television version of the scene, low-key had me absolutely broken. We find out in this VHS tape that James is the one responsible for Mary's death, suffocating her with a pillow due to frustration over her sickness. After this, we tell Laura the news, and it goes down about as well as you'd expect.
Mary's gone. She's dead.
That's a lie!
No, that's not true.
She died because she was sick?
No, I killed her.
You kill her! Why'd you do it? I hate you! I want her back! Give her back to me! I knew it! You didn't care about her! I hate you, James! I hate you! I hate you! I hate you! She was always waiting for you. Why? Why?
Yeah, if nothing else has been assigned for you, things are about to get dark from here on out. So, I'm gonna make a few jokes here and there, but for the most part, I'm going to stop making those just because I think the subject matter gets too serious for me to interject any humor. After this, the hotel shifts once again into the other world. We enter a staircase where we meet Angela one last time.
Maybe then I can rest.
What?
Mama, why are you running away? You're not my mama. It's you. Oh, I'm sorry.
Angela, no.
Thank you for saving me. But I wish you hadn't. Even Mama said it. I deserved what happened.
No, Angela, that's wrong.
No, don't pity me. I'm not worth it. Or maybe you think you can save me. Will you love me? Take care of me? Heal all my pain? That's what I thought. James, give me back that knife.
No, I won't.
Saving it for yourself?
Me? No. I'd never kill myself. It's hot as hell in here.
You see it too. For me, it's always like this.
At this point, Angela, overcome with, I guess, guilt from the realization that she killed her abusive father and brother, walks up into the flaming stairs, into the billowing smoke, never to be seen again. As you can probably tell by what I'm doing here, you can't do anything to save Angela. She goes off on her own, and we never see her again. Not in any of the sequels, not in anything else. After this, we have one last encounter with Pyramid Head. We open the door and once again, we see Maria. That's when this happens. We just have two more boss battles and then ending. Maria, you do realize that dying is bad for your health, right?
You did.
I was weak. That's why I needed you. Needed someone to punish me for my sins. But that's all over now. I know the truth. Now it's time to end this.
Sine equals cosine plus tangent. Is it acute or obtuse, James?
Eventually, the two pyramid heads kill each other in the middle of the room.
Yes!
There we go. They're dead. After this, you go into the final endings. So I'm actually going to go into the rest of the review because, well, I want to talk about the endings with a little more context behind them. For anyone who's wondering what endings will be covered in this video, I'm going to cover the four kind of more realistic endings. I know that there's the dog ending, I know that there's the UFO ending, but I feel like neither of those are really important to my overall coverage of Silent Hill 2. While yes, I acknowledge there is a humorous side to Silent Hill 2, I don't think it's important enough that we cover that in this video.
Excuse me, I...
I'm sorry, I was just...
No, it's okay. I didn't mean to scare you. I'm kind of lost.
Lost?
Yeah, I'm looking for Silent Hill. Is this the right way?
Yeah. It's hard to see with this fog, but there's only the one road. You can't miss it.
Thanks.
But...
Yes?
I think you'd better stay away. This town, there's something wrong with it. It's kind of hard to explain, but...
Is it dangerous?
Maybe. And it's not just the fog, either.
Okay,
it's...
I got it. I'll be careful.
I'm not lying!
No. I believe you. It's just... I guess I really don't care if it's dangerous or not.
Analyzing Silent Hill 2 is a lot harder than other games. I would say mainly because Silent Hill 2, as a piece of media, is psychological. Granted, I will say that all horror is to some extent psychological, since fear is a psychological reaction, but with good psychological media, what it does is make you ask questions, and a decent amount of those questions will never get satisfying answers. Take, for example, The Shining. The Shining is one of those movies that even to this day people have questions about. There are theories floating around that this movie is Kubrick's confession that he faked the moon landing. There are questions about who's insane, who isn't. And that just kind of reflects on why The Shining is so effective. For another example, Evangelion. Evangelion is one of those shows where I did an analysis of it a long, long time ago. And even then, I acknowledge you can't really understand everything about it. I would argue that Silent Hill 2 falls into this exact same camp. You see, while there are some questions that are meant to be answered and some things that can be derived, there's just as many things that appear to have no answers. For starters, let's look at what we know for sure. The monsters are a manifestation of James' psychological problems. And while Pyramid Head is the most direct analog, to some extent almost every monster you see reflects this. From the straitjackets, which are, as the name implies, restrained, they can't move in a natural way, almost seems to reflect the state of Mary before her death as someone who is bedridden. Or the nurses, which are slightly more sexual than the nurses that were present in Silent Hill 1, and reflect James's sexual frustration over the fact that his wife has been sick. But let's stop beating around the bush and get into everyone's favorite piece of geometry, Pyramid Head. Pyramid Head is perhaps the most iconic part of Silent Hill 2. You see, while on the surface he might just seem like another stereotypical killer, for example, something like Nemesis from Resident Evil 3 or Mr. X from the Resident Evil 2 games, there's something more to Pyramid Head. You see, throughout the game, you often see Pyramid Head engaging in acts with other monsters. And Pyramid Head, in a weird way, if you compare him to the other creatures of the game, almost seems to be acting independently of whatever else is going on in Silent Hill. You see, whereas the other monsters might have just an agenda to kill anything in sight, Pyramid Head's goal seems to be to punish and torment James. Whether it be him killing Maria multiple times throughout the story, or the fact that in every boss fight with him, it's not determined by how much you damage him, whether he dies or not, but by time. Since Pyramid Head is a representation of guilt, in a way this is reflective of how guilt acts. Guilt is not something that you can fully overcome by simply facing it head on most of the time. It's something that, while facing it head on can help alleviate or help shorten the time span of, you can't eradicate it completely. You see, Pyramid Head is James Sunderland. In a weird comparison here, if you were to take almost any other horror villain and try to put them with a different protagonist, it would be fine. For example, and I don't mean this to insult Halloween fans, if you were to put Michael Myers into Camp Crystal Lake, while he might operate a slight bit differently and he might be a little bit bummed out that he can't stalk his favorite stalkee, who has now gotten a shotgun and created a whole house and prepared for many, many decades for this, he's still going to operate the exact same. But Pyramid Head is exclusive to James Sunderland. even though his design is based off the executioners of Silent Hill, the people who, as their name implies, would execute people for their sins, Pyramid Head isn't a dumb, rambling monster. Rather, he is a agent, if you will. A force that seeks to make James pay and repent for his actions. In a weird way, even though he's kind of become the face of this game, Pyramid Head only works here. And this can easily be seen in the later games, when they try to take Pyramid Head and put him in there, or even in the movies, where, well, he's absolutely jacked. Which, since I'm speaking about his design very briefly, let's talk about it. If you look at Pyramid Head, he's wearing an apron made of treated human skin. And his figure is tall, towering over most of the other cast members. The weapons that he carries are often over-encumbered, or something where it's unwieldy, larger. You see, Pyramid Head isn't the kind of character who would carry something light and easy. He's dragging around the weights of James's past. In particular, his worst sin of all, his murder of Mary. While Pyramid Head acts as a antagonistic foil to James, there are actually more characters who reflect James within the town than first meets the eye. For example, there's Angela. Angela, as is heavily implied, if not outright stated in her story, is a victim of sexual assault from her father and her brother, people who she was supposed to trust and be cared for by. As a result, she murdered both of them. Granted, the difference between Angela and James is that with Angela, you can at least see the justification for a murder, and while you might not agree with her method, you can definitely understand why she came to that conclusion, and in a weird way, almost justify it. Then there's Eddie, who, while unhinged, uncomfortable, and definitely one of the most repulsive characters in this game, definitely has this weird reflection upon James. After Eddie's death is when the tone begins to shift. You see, while Eddie's there, it almost feels like James is more tempered. While there are hints that James has a darker past, hints that James may have done things he's not proud of, for example, after you exit the hospital, James makes a few remarks that are a little bit suspicious, after he kills Eddie, the way that he says a human being genuinely gives me chills. The first time he says it, he's unsure. He's not confident in the fact that he just took someone else's life. But then he says it again, with this conviction that almost feels like he's more familiar with it than we would expect. This feeling of, it was self-defense, it was justified. I mean, I had to do it, I guess. But in a weird way with James, it feels like more than that. You see, the weird thing with James is that as a protagonist, he's fairly morally gray. While most of the time, their protagonists fall into one of two camps. Number one, a heavily story-based character who the player might have some control over, but for the most part, kind of follows a set path, or a character who the player can reflect themselves on and has almost complete control over. James falls in that weird middle ground. He has a set story, but yet at the same time, if you look at James,
he doesn't have that sympathetic story. You're not supposed to connect with James, and the game almost implies that with the design. From the fact that attacks somewhat feel disjointed, to the fact that compared to almost any other game that I've played, it's very hard to get into a flow state with things like combat, or even to some extent the controls, you never feel fully immersed in James, even though you definitely feel fully immersed in the town of Silent Hill. What also helps with this is the camera angles. You see, something that's prevalent in all of the early Silent Hill games is their use of the camera. Oftentimes, they will use a technique called Dutch angles. This is when you face the camera at an angle that's diagonal upward at the character, or in Silent Hill's case, usually it's up a flight of stairs. Beyond that, they'll often turn cameras, put cameras at awkward angles so you can't really see what's ahead or behind you, and take a lot of different ways that they can use to make you feel disconnected. Compare this to the camera angles in something like Silent Hill 1 or 3, and while yes, there are definitely moments where they use the same tricks, Silent Hill 2 has entire sections where the camera's above you, or sections where the camera is loosely following James. Part of it might just be because, well, Silent Hill 3 focused a little more on combat than the previous two, but in Silent Hill 3, there's a lot more moments where it feels like the camera's up close and personal with Heather. But you don't get that often with James. And even then, the only times that you are in first person are in cutscenes, when you're looking at other characters suffering. For example, with the death of Angela, the reason why that scene is in first person is that you're supposed to sympathize with Angela. Even though she is just as much a murderer as someone like James or Eddie, her suffering isn't fully justified to the same extent. You can make the argument of her being a victim of circumstance. Unlike James or Eddie, whose motivations were partially selfish, Angela's seemed to be protection. But with all that being said, why do I think Silent Hill is one of the most cohesive experiences ever put to a disc? The answer is actually quite simple. Whereas other games in the horror genre will oftentimes use the, I guess, conventions of gameplay to try to generate horror, Silent Hill 2 seems to go the other direction. You see, the horror of Silent Hill 2 comes from a fear of the unknown for most of the story, but also this feeling of uncanniness that you get from a protagonist like James. Everything from the fact that the voice acting isn't traditional and sounds very human, but at the same time, almost every character comes across as a little unhinged. You can't really trust anyone, even if you want to. Heck, even the kid, Laura, who in almost any other game would be the sympathetic character who you're trying to escort, is constantly running from you, shoves you into a boss fight one or two times, and at the end, even outright calls you a monster, is telling. You see, whereas other horror games like to use their mechanics to inspire horror, whether it be limiting resources or making sure that you can't just save wherever you want, Silent Hill 2, despite to some extent also having this, for example, there are weapons with various amounts of ammunition, and there are also a few moments where you need to be very careful and try to make it to the next save point, please. There are just as many moments where the horror isn't from something that is coming from that gameplay, but the gameplay is definitely helping with it.
You see, with the survival horror genre as a whole, one thing that is often known by people who play these games is that you need to be careful with ammunition and save it for things like boss fights, because if you try to kill every single enemy, it's not going to end well for you. Sometimes it's better to leave that zombie shambling in the corner because, well, it's not too much of a problem and I know how to avoid it. But with Silent Hill 2... it seems more like they give you the choice of how you want to interact with it. You see, even with the endings, which we are going to get into here in just a few minutes, they are not clear with how you can achieve them. Granted, there are a few smaller guidelines. For example, you have to read a journal entry on top of the hospital roof, you have to do X, Y, or Z to achieve some of the secret endings post your first playthrough. If you look at how all the default endings are achieved, there seems to be a vagueness to it. There are things you can do to influence which ending you get, but you can't really guarantee the one that you will end up seeing. Silent Hill 2 was not designed to be a game that's fully understood. And even though I know I'm doing an analysis video on it, and probably should not be saying this, no matter how much I analyze this game, there's still going to be more that I cannot cover. With good psychological media, no matter how hard you scratch at the surface, there's always more to see. And that's not just because it was intentionally designed that way, or because there actually is that much depth, but because this media is so open to an interpretation that, well, you can always find something else. Instead of this type of media acting like a book, it's more like a mirror. The more and more you look into it, you see how it reflects upon itself and reflects upon you. I have seen people make analysis of this game in totally different directions and seen validity to both sides. Silent Hill 2 is psychological horror. It's a game that can't be known, a game that can't be fully quantified, and therein lies the reason why it has been so revered for decades. Silent Hill 2 is over 20 years old at this point, and yet there are still people trying to analyze it. Now, I'm going to talk about the endings here in just a second, but since it was announced a little bit before I started working on this video, let's talk about the HD remakes. You see, Silent Hill 2, while receiving one HD thing in the form of HD collection, which you are probably familiar with my opinions on by this point, is getting an HD remake by Bloober Team. Now, I'm going to be a little bit of an outlier here and say I actually like some of Bloober Team's work. If you have not played The Observer, that is a wholehearted recommendation from me, and I'm going to be honest, I have a soft spot for Layers of Fear. I don't know why, I can't really quantify it, but I just like the series. However, I will full well admit that after games like The Medium or Blair Witch, it does make me a little anxious to see how they'll handle Silent Hill 2. You see, Silent Hill 2 as a game is very much reflective of that original team that worked on it. Everything from the music of Akira Yamaoka, to the original monster designs, to just the entire aesthetic of the town, to the character models having slight imperfections that make it feel oddly more human. Silent Hill 2 is an experience that I feel can't be captured without the utmost care. Granted, there are a few issues that I saw right off the bat. Number one, as I briefly mentioned earlier, the camera angles. You see, Silent Hill 2 Remake is going to have an over-the-shoulder camera, which, while I don't really dislike over-the-shoulder cameras, I think sometimes they get a bad rap, is absolutely something I don't want to see in a Silent Hill game. See, Silent Hill often relies on its camera angles for its horror, and while something like Resident Evil has enough of an action-based gameplay that with Resident Evil 4 they could switch to that style of over-the-shoulder camera and make it work, Silent Hill just doesn't seem to have that same kind of feeling to it. Number two, I don't like some of the character redesigns. Giving James a stubble just feels odd to me. Number one, I like the idea that someone actually proposed to me about it, because I mentioned the stubble made me feel uncomfortable. If James is going to meet his long-dead wife, and he thinks there's even a chance, would he really show up with the stubble, or would he shave his face so he's looking his best? I'm fine with the unkempt hair. I'm fine with the slight bits of design that harken back to the original. But there just seemed to be a few things where they didn't really hit the mark. Pyramid Head's design is actually pretty good. That's one thing I was worried about, especially since, well, I love Pyramid Head and Dead by Daylight, but I didn't want them to just pull that design, and harkening more so back to the original than something from the movies, yeah, I think they made the right choice in that. But if I'm being fully honest, I'm not too optimistic. You see, Bloober Team doesn't have the best history of handling controversial topics like suicide or sexual assault. And Silent Hill 2 has these topics in it. Now, granted, I feel like if you have the right team overseeing it, it could have potential, but Silent Hill 2 is just sitting right there. It's a perfect game. If you just ported it to modern consoles, a lot of people would be more than happy. And here's the thing, I feel like there would have been a better game for them to remake. Silent Hill 1 has been sitting on the PS1 for, well, a really long time, over 2 decades at this point, and aside from a Game Boy Advance release, which was a visual novel, it hasn't appeared on anything else to any notable degree. It was available on a few digital online stores, but I think the game deserves to make a reappearance. Whether it's just as a re-release on the PlayStation's PS1 library, which has steadily been growing and honestly looks pretty decent, or what I would say more ideally, give that game the remake it deserves. While yes, there is Shattered Memories, which is a reimagining of that first game, it's not a remake. We all know it. What would be great to see would be them taking the same amount of love and care and putting it towards Silent Hill 1. A game that, while I think should still be available in its original form, seems like it's the perfect candidate for Konami to ask for a remake of. It's just sitting there. While Silent Hill 2 and 3 have, despite the fact that not legally, been available for quite a few ways to play, Silent Hill 1 is stuck on a PlayStation. Whether you want to burn a CD and try to play it, or emulate it, it's more struggle than most people are willing to go through, and for people who only like to go through legal methods, your only option is to own a PS1 and then try to find a disc, which has been steadily increasing in price and now is so ridiculously high that I don't want to touch it with a 10-foot pole. But with all that being said, I want this remake to be good. I'm not saying this to be negative, I'm not saying it to be purely pessimistic. I'm saying all this because I hope I'm wrong. I love Silent Hill 2, and even though I think that I will stick to the original release, I think that there should be options available for newer people who want, for people newer to gaming who want to experience these older games. Whether it be in the form of the Resident Evil remakes, which reimagined Resident Evil 2 and 3 in a more modern style, or even something more subtle like Resident Evil 1's remake, which just upped the graphical quality and added some quality of life improvements, I feel there is always room to take an old product and make it new. However, I want this remake to provide that same experience. While I'm not asking for something like a complete rehash of the original with an HD texture pack, I want that sense of mystique to be surrounding the town once again. If the past direct showed us anything, it's that the future for Silent Hill is up in the air just as much as it was before. While yes, there were a few projects announced, and I'm going to go ahead and say what I think about each of them, Silent Hill F looks absolutely astounding, and since it was written by the same person who made Higurashi, I'm somewhat optimistic about its chances. I feel like it kind of more so holds the position of a spin-off than a mainline entry, but it looks interesting. Silent Hill Townfall also has, I would say, a great amount of potential. I've played a few of the games by that developer, and I tend to like them. I know some people don't really like the idea of a Silent Hill game that has a decent amount of the story told through things like radios or TVs, but I think there's potential there, especially with the whole rise of analog horror in recent years. Maybe there's something they could do to make it interesting. But there's also a lot to be anxious about. Outside of the remake of 2, they announced a... I don't know what the heck that other thing was, I'm gonna be honest. I don't know if it's an ARG, TV show, and then another movie. And if I was anxious about the game, I'm terrified about the movie. You see, I actually like the first Silent Hill movie. It's a guilty pleasure of mine. I'm not gonna act like either of the two Silent Hill movies are masterpieces on the same level of the games. But there's something about taking two and putting it into a movie, and just with how Konami phrased it, that kind of worries me. And while I hope this fear is completely unfounded and both turn out to be fairly good, I'll be lying if I said my hopes were completely high for the movie. But I think all that negativity should be done for. Let's talk about the endings. Starting with what I would regard as the best ending when it comes to what James finds. It's the dog ending! Okay, no. No, we're not doing the dog ending. I do love the dog ending, though. They actually announced a figure for that in the direct, and I was very happy about that. But anyway, I need to stop going on tangents. Sharp Z, get back to the review. The ending where James leaves town with Laura is, well, a fairly good ending. I would say that it doesn't provide the most satisfying end to the narrative, but it's definitely the best one for James. He leaves and fulfills Mary's wish by presumably adopting Laura. Granted, we don't see what happens after they leave the town. For all I know, James puts Laura in the backseat of his car, drives to the nearest orphanage, and drops her off. I mean, considering that she made my life a living hell for about 3 or 4 hours, that's probably what I would do. But, I mean, I'm not James Sunderland. I haven't murdered my wife. I don't have a wife. I'm constantly lonely.
This is a cry for help. There's also the Leave with Maria ending where, well, after defeating the final boss, James leaves with Maria. However, right before leaving, Maria lets out a pretty nasty cough, implying that she has the exact same illness that Mary did. However, there is one ending that I would argue is the best ending of the game. An ending that I think better than any other summarizes what Silent Hill 2 is. At this point in the game, there's very little left, so I'm just going to briefly summarize what's still here. So, you grab some eggs from the dead pyramid heads, open the doors, and you enter a hallway. In this hallway, you can hear Mary talking back and forth with James.
Go home already.
And
Mary, what are you
after
saying?
Exiting the hallway, you go up another flight of stairs, which I think is from a port right beside the dock. And, well, you enter the rooftop building. At this point,
I think
you
canon.
See
the
Mary.
Ending I personally consider canon.
However, this is where it differs slightly depending on the ending. So, in, I believe, every single ending except for the Maria ending,
Mary.
When you talk to Mary, you slowly realize that's not Mary, that's Maria. At which point you tell you tell Maria that she will never be Mary, and boss fight ensues. In the Leave with Maria ending, it's revealed that it's Mary, and she's jealous that you're trying to replace her with Maria. Now, with those two endings aside, let's get into the one that I think is the best ending of Silent Hill 2. Thematically, that is. Not in its ending for the characters. Silent Hill 2's in-water ending is widely regarded as its best. And honestly, while usually I would like to buck the consensus, I actually can't disagree here. So, how the in-water ending starts is, as I mentioned earlier, with Maria being revealed to have dressed up as Mary after you beat the boss fight. You get a brief moment with Mary in her hospital room, in which she tells James that she wanted him to be able to forgive himself for what he's done.
Mary?
James.
Forgive me.
I told you that I wanted to die, James. I wanted the pain to end.
That's why I did it, honey. I just couldn't watch you suffer. No. That's not the whole truth. You also said that you didn't want to die. The truth is, part of me hated you for taking away my life.
You killed me, and you're suffering for it. It's enough, James.
Mary?
James!
After Mary passes away, James picks up her corpse and walks out with it,
assumedly putting the corpse into the trunk of his car, he starts the car, drives into Toluca Lake, and drowns himself and Mary. Now, granted, a lot of what I'm saying here is just assumed, because the beauty of the In Water ending is its subtlety. But in Silent Hill 2, it doesn't show any of that. All it is now Mary's letter slowly scrolling over descending waters.
What was I afraid of? Without you,
as James Mary, drowns within
I've
the
got
lake,
nothing.
It's almost as if this is Mary's final goodbye to him. Her final wish for his happiness. And
now,
in a way, this is James' recompense. Well, yes, I do acknowledge that earlier it seems like James was able to get over his desire to die.
Silent Hill.
I feel like this is the most fitting ending.
You promised you'd take me there again someday.
In a way, why James came here was to be with Mary once again. That's why he came to Silent Hill once he received the letter. There is more to it than
waiting for you to come.
Just a whim, I believe.
But you never
thematically, this ties the beginning of the game
and so I wait
with the end, the best.
Wrapped in my
James is finally with Mary.
Loneliness.
Even if it's in death.
I know I've done a terrible thing.
At
to
this
you.
Point,
something you'll never forgive me for.
Silent Hill 2 feels conclusive.
I wish I could change that.
Even without all questions answered, and with the threat of where Laura exactly is
I
not exactly
so
wound up anywhere, this
waiting
feels conclusive. It feels like a fitting end for
Every
James that he would meet
up
tragedy.
At the cracks in the ceiling.
A fitting end that someone who came to this town and slowly watches person after person fall to it would eventually fall to it himself.
The doctor came today.
But in a weird way, there is still a hope in the form of Laura.
For a short stay.
I know I've made a lot of jokes at her expense throughout this video, and that's because, well, yeah, she genuinely is a little goblin at times. But Laura is Mary's hope for the future. And I feel like
Maybe
if
so.
Team Silent Hill continues these games,
I'm glad to be coming
eventually we would probably see that.
I've missed you.
Honestly,
terribly.
That's the one thing I've always wanted to see in a sequel to Silent Hill is a continuation of the story
I'm
of Laura.
Afraid, James.
But
I'm afraid you don't
I digress.
Really want me to come home.
I believe the In Water ending is
when
a perfect summation of what makes Silent Hill great.
How hard it is on
it's
me.
Subtle. It's not in your face. If you compare Silent Hill 2 to Silent Hill 1, the amount of blood and gore in this game is
or maybe I just
pretty much nothing. While this game has bloody scenes, while this game has moments that are absolutely violent,
when I first learned that I was
it never relies on that blood or gore to shock you.
I just didn't want
Instead, it's the actions of those around you that are shocking.
I was so
It's the
angry
fact that
all
James,
the
character who's the protagonist,
I struck out at
a role which
I loved
usually
most.
Gives an unspoken bond between
Especially
the developer and the player,
James.
That I'm not playing as the bad guy unless you explicitly state it to me,
That's why
defies that trust.
I understand if you do hate me.
Then you have other characters
I want you
like
to know this, James.
Angela, who, despite being essentially a.
I'll always.
Well, side character almost has her own story, and I feel in any lesser game would be cast in the protagonist role. She has a justified meaning. Even though she's committed sins in her past, it's not something like James where it feels completely evil. If anything,
this letter has gone on too long.
James would make more sense as the side character. Someone who you don't know
I'll
whether to sympathize with or root for, but this
I
choice was deliberate.
This
game is not designed to feel conclusive or happy.
As you read
it's a game that is designed to make you
I'm
think.
Already dead.
Whether the people who were making this game knew it or not, their creation would have a profound impact on the horror genre as a whole. I'm saying this as someone who full well loves Silent Hill 2. I feel like it inevitably spelled death for the Silent Hill franchise. You see, Silent Hill 3, while still an amazing game, lacked some of the more psychological elements of Silent Hill 2. Even though, yes, there is the part of the narrative that involves Heather being a teenager, it's not as pronounced as Silent Hill 2's narrative. And even beyond that, if you look at the rest of Silent Hill, every protagonist after Heather, and I would say to some extent even after Silent Hill 4 The Room, seem to need some kind of sin or darkness within their past. And even though that's kind of an interesting concept, when it happens every time, it's not as effective. Part of what makes James' story so effective is the fact that you can't really tell there's any darkness within him at first. At first, James more so seems calm and calculated. After all, this is a survival horror game. I mean, while it's fine to have your protagonist reacting crazy to everything, sometimes it makes sense that they would just be like, oh well, I guess I'll roll with it. But James doesn't follow that. James is someone who just doesn't fit your stereotypical protagonist mold. You see, psychological media requires something to be surprising, requires something to make you think. And Silent Hill 2 succeeded in that. But it feels like almost every game that wants to call itself psychological horror, while rightfully taking some inspiration from Silent Hill 2, sometimes takes a little too much. I'm not saying that a story similar to Silent Hill 2's could not be done well again. Honestly, I would love to see it. But if you're going to do it, make sure that everything from the ground up is leading to it. Make sure that the revelations and plot twists make sense, and make sure that you write it in such a way that it's more so there to make people think. Writing solely for shock value, while it can be short-term effective, does not yield good long-term results. With all that being said, I think it's finally time to say goodbye to the town of Silent Hill. Maybe next year I'll visit it once again, maybe reviewing Silent Hill 1, 3, or even 4. But I think this is the perfect time to wrap it up. We've been here for a little over an hour now, and, well, I think it's time to return to my restless dreams. So, without further ado, this is Sharp Z, signing off.
These last few years since I became ill, I am so sorry for what I did to you, did to us. You've given me so much, and I haven't been able to return a single thing. That's why I want you to live for yourself now. Do what's best for you, James. James. You made me happy.
So,
I just wanted to briefly record this, I guess, as an apology. I said that this video was going to come out a long time before it actually did. Like, it's been, I want to say, about a week since I originally planned on releasing this, but a lot has happened. My grandmother's funeral was at the end of October, and around that time was when a lot of the script writing was still being finalized, so that kind of bumped things back a bit. And then, between other things like midterms and just other exams, I've just been busy. And to top it all off, today I find out that my cat, who I've had for 10 years, is going to need to be put down due to cancer. So life's just been hard recently. I'm sorry this took so long to come out, but I feel it's almost fitting that this is the game that I cover for that. Silent Hill 2 speaks to me on that level. I feel like it's a game that understood me during this time. A game that didn't give me answers to what I was seeking, but definitely helped me find a few things and work a few things out. So I just wanted to record a brief epilogue for this. Anyway, needless to say, just with how life's been recently, I'm gonna try to get the other videos I have planned out on a decent schedule. But it's a little hard to make content right now, needless to say. So I just want to ask for people to be patient with me. I'm sorry, once again. Until next time, guys. This is Sharp Z, signing off.